Hello and welcome to the 9th tutorial based on the topics presented at IB Experts Firebird School, held by Holger Klemt and Jason Chapman as part of the International Firebird Conference 2007. In the first part of this topic, writing store procedures and triggers, we'll start by looking at programming the Firebird server. What are store procedures and triggers, their composition, and what they can do? So, let's briefly start by looking at reasons for server-side programming. Firstly, speed of execution. Server-side programming does exactly what it says. The work is done on the server and the results are sent out to the client. Client-side programming fetches all data and tables it might need and then sorts and analyzes them on the client PC. So if you've got to perform computations on a large database or table, you've got to suck all the data back to the workstation to actually do the work. This can lead to time-consuming queries, traffic congestion, and long wait times for the user. It is possible for a stored procedure to achieve up to 50,000 operations per second. A front-end program, such as Delphi or PHP, is lucky to achieve 3,000 operations a second. And when you're writing procedures, you can use procedural SQL, which gives you more features and functionalities than you can use than if you were just sat on the client. You can see just how quick a stored procedure is in the IB Expert Demo Database, DB1, with the procedure in it all, which performs around 800,000 operations. Each database operation remains in the database and is not sent to the client or anywhere else to perform its commands. For example, running the initAll procedure as a stored procedure takes around 30 seconds. Running it as an IBE block procedure, in principle similar to a Delphi program, takes around 220 seconds. IBE block does exactly the same operations as the stored procedure, but handles them in separate client SQL statements. So, that gives you an idea of the performance advantages that you can get out of your database using stored procedures. Consistency is also important. Database operations performed on the server are either completed successfully or rolled back, that is, not executed at all. They are never partially completed. Another advantage of server-side programming is when you have different front-ends. For example, Delphi and PHP doing similar things. Programming both to call a single procedure to perform a task is not just easier than programming the whole thing twice, it also ensures consistency. Both applications call the same procedure and are therefore guaranteed to provide the same result. Any alterations that may need to be made in the future only need to be made once, directly in the procedure. Modularity. Stored procedures can be written for singular tasks such as order taking, order processing, and dispatch. They can then call each other. Modularity is easy to comprehend, which also makes future adjustments easier. And in the example where Delphi and PHP applications share the same database, modularity is achieved, as any alterations that may need to be made in the future only need to be made once directly in the procedure. Even though PSQL, procedural SQL, is not initially so easy to write as IDEs, if you want to develop efficient high-performance database applications, it is vital you take the time and effort to get to grips with this. Stored procedures and triggers. You can differentiate between executable and selectable stored procedures. An executable stored procedure is, for example, execute procedure SP name. A selectable stored procedure example would be select star from SP name. Triggers are table or database linked types of procedure. Their syntax and functionalities are identical to stored procedures. However, they can access certain variables, and they are triggered automatically, hence the name. In Firebird 2.1 upwards, I can specify a database trigger, and I can define the event on connect, on disconnect, on transaction start, on transaction commit, or on transaction rollback. And I can incorporate a relatively simple protocol recording who logged in and logged out and when. So that's just one of the possibilities of the use of triggers. Let's look at procedure composition. Executable procedures do not normally have a result set. They can, though, actually return one row or one set of variables back. We'll take a closer look in a minute at a stored procedure result set when we look at debugging. An executable procedure can, for example, execute certain operations in a certain defined order without the end user, that is the person calling the procedure, knowing anything about it. An example of an executable stored procedure which combines separate operations can be seen here. Create procedure delete X as begin. Delete from order line, delete from orders, delete from inventory, end. This procedure, delete X, simply deletes from order line, from orders, and then from inventory. It simply performs a series of specified operations in a specified order without the end user being aware of it. The procedure is started by the command execute procedure delete X. Suspend and returns. Many people find the keyword suspend a little suspect. It is fairly simple to understand. If we take a look at this procedure, create procedure dummy returns text varchar 10. Suspend basically says stop execution of what you're doing now and push some data back to the client. So every time there's a suspend, whatever it said it was going to return, for example here text, it will be pushed back on the suspend. Here there is a return, a variable, text varchar 10. So in the procedure, in the return variable, I enter the word dog, and then I suspend. Imagine it is a sort of stack. You push a data set up and then enter something new. And using the keyword suspend, the next data set is pushed up. In this way, I can generate a quantity of data, which we can later take a look at with the debugger to see how this data is created in such a procedure. In this example, if you do select star from dummy, you'll get back dog, cat, mouse, each in an individual row. And I can incorporate the keyword suspend into a procedure and can use it to define data in a form perhaps not possible in SQL. It is also possible to define a cross-classified table view in a procedure, which, although the data is actually defined tabular in a column, it is summarized in a report alongside each other, where I can tell a report generator, select star from stored procedure. This can be a great aid, particularly for reporting. So you see, you really can do a lot of things with a procedure. For select suspend. So we have a procedure here that performs certain operations. Let's take this procedure and execute it on the demo database. The procedure is created using procedure command. I'll execute it in the IBExpert SQL editor and commit it. Now we can see it. This procedure basically does the following. It searches in a for select loop relevant entries in the table and then gives me the resulting data quantity. When I start this procedure, I need to say which actor I am looking for. Here, for example, Stallone. Then it searches through all the data and it gives me all the relevant results. That is, all films starring Stallone. Now I can also try alternatives. For example, I can specify in the outer for select loop a condition on the price. If price larger than 30, then price equals 30. So I can add business logic into a procedure. Here you see a result list with all prices over 30 rounded down. So basically, I can make any modular specifications I wish. And while we're on the subject, a small tip. If you look here, select first 10, title, actor, price from product, and enter Stallone again, I can see only the first 10 results. What can be a problem, though, is when I specify the following as a variable. Declare variable I integer. Begin for select first I, title, actor, price from product. Then I'll get an error message. For those of you who have encountered this problem before and wish to specify this as a variable, you need to include brackets. It won't accept colon I. You have to enter bracket, colon I, bracket. If I specify I equals 10, then it functions in exactly the same way as before. It's necessary to use brackets when using first, next, and skip operators. So, how is this data generated? Let's take a closer look at this. This for select loop runs in the following order. I can show it to you in the IBExpert debugger. It starts here with variables. We've got a variable name, an input variable, and the variables title, actor, and price are left empty. So, something has to be entered in the input variable. We'll stick with Stallone. And now I'll go through the procedure. I arrive next at I equals 10. So the debugger has extracted the first data set. You can see the information in the variables. We can check here that the price is $49.90. Then when I press the F8 key, the price is reset to 30. If I press F8 again, it goes into the first loop part and displays the next data set. Each time, using the keyword suspend, one data set meeting the specified conditions is returned. I can see the progress down here on the results page. This is how a selectable stored procedure works. And when 10 data sets have been returned, the stored procedure is completed. And this way, it is possible to analyze even complex procedures. There are, of course, some people who don't use procedures because they think they can't be debugged. You can debug them easily and quickly using the right tools. The excuse for not using procedures due to the wish to remain database independent needs to also take into account the huge loss in performance. So, that was for select. We'll continue in part 2 of our tutorial series, Writing Stored Procedures and Triggers, with a look at the execute statement and execute procedure, and we'll briefly introduce you to while, leave, break, and recursions and modularity. Goodbye for now, and thank you from all of us at IB Expert. ¶¶